The Everything You Want to Know About Bird Feeders Guide. Copyright 2006, all rights reserved. Introduction. According to my cute-as-a-button 5-year-old niece, a bird feeder is not that collection of wood, wire, and plastic that I have sitting so proudly in my backyard. It is, in fact, as she so proudly and logically informed me, herself. Now, I know that might sound a little bit confusing to everyone out there who thought that their bird feeders were inanimate objects acting as receptacles for any food that you might put in it. But you'll be glad to know that in my case, at least, and yours too, according to my niece, it's the person who actually goes out there and puts the food in the bird feeder who is the actual bird feeder, not the feeder itself. Hopefully that wasn't too confusing. But just to be sure, let me clarify the point and tell you verbatim what my niece said. She said, quote, "No, no, 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 no. That's not the bird feeder, silly. I'm the bird feeder." At this point, she looked up at me with her big eyes and her lower lip sticking out and asked me, "Don't I feed the birds good then?" Naturally, I kind of start to feel like a heel, and I rush in to tell her that she feeds the birds good and that, yes, she's the bird feeder and not that pile of cedar or glass and copper that's standing so proudly in front of my living room window. Besides, who can contradict such an abundantly clear piece of 5-year-old logic? From her point of view, she really is the bird feeder, so who am I to go against it? Having now satisfactorily disposed of that little piece of nonsense out of the way, I read the whole thing back to my niece, who was tickled pink, actually, at being mentioned in the book. We can now hopefully move on to the matters of great import and concern to all bird lovers, namely that of bird feeders. I know that the topic of bird feeders is kind of an odd choice to write a book about, but to me, it encompasses the best of both worlds. Not only do I get to write about my favorite subject, birds, just in case you couldn't guess, but I also get to tell it to a bunch of enthusiastic birders who understand the absolute necessity of having their own bird feeder in their backyard. If you're reading this introduction and you're wondering, just what are you talking about? Or you think that I'm just playing off my rocker, two reasons could account for this. You're getting this book for someone else who is a bird enthusiast and just kind of wanted to see whether it's worth your while to give it to them. Or you've only just started on your life of birding and haven't yet become as far gone as I have in my birding pursuits. If it's more the former case, then let me assure you now that it's highly worth your while giving this book to your favorite birder. And if it's the latter case, well then rest assured that before very long, you'll understand what I'm talking about. As an ardent bird enthusiast, I've sometimes been accused of speaking a different language by my family. So be warned, fair bird reader, though I might sometimes lapse into the strange and wonderful language at times, I will always do my utmost best to explain such terms to you. In fact, I'll start right now and tell you that when I say birder, I mean a person who's enthusiastic about birds and particular bird-related pursuits. Birding means the actual pursuit of all things birds. Hummer is an affectionate shortened term for those tiny little hummingbirds. And bird feeder. I use this term interchangeably throughout the book, and it's mainly case-specific. So although most times I will be referring to the actual bird-feeding stations, there are times when I will take a leaf out of my niece's book and be referring to you instead. So hopefully that will avoid some confusion as you read along. What will you get out of this book? Why are you reading a book and what's the aim of it? Well, is it merely a frivolous book written on the aspects of bird feeding, or does it hold any information that's of use? Only you can decide whether it's of any use to you. But my intention was to try and demystify the odd world known to all birders as bird feeding. To that end, I've sectioned the book off in what I hope are logical sequences, but which will all ultimately tie together anyway. You might find that parts are repeated here and there where it was absolutely unavoidable for me to keep it out. As you go along, you'll find that almost everything in birding is interrelated, and you can't just go into one subject without encroaching on another. In these cases, I've not rehashed the same information, but have instead referred you back to the original section where there's more detail. So, what can you get out of this book? Besides odd insights into my crazy world? Well, basically, almost anything and everything that you'll ever want to know about birding. Naturally, there are some things that aren't covered here, but for the most part, you should find what you need to start you off on a jaunt into the world of bird feeding. Bird feeders, what they are. If you have a rough idea of what a bird feeder is, besides my niece, that is, then you're probably on the right track. A bird feeder is simply something upon which you can place food for birds to enjoy. The variety in bird feeding comes from the different types of bird feeders that are available. They can range from simple do-it-yourself bird feeding platforms to state-of-the-art bird feeders with devices and accessories that outshine the birds themselves. For detailed descriptions of some of the different types of feeders available, you can skip ahead to the section entitled Different Types of Bird Feeders. For a description on how to build your own bird feeder, you can go to the section called Building Your Own Bird Feeder. Basically, though, if you've just started this bird feeding lark, I know, that was a bad pun. You can start out in a simple manner and progress from there. Of course, you can always have the option of plunging into the deep end of the pool, and that's all right as well. Every journey starts with the first step, and it's really up to you where your first step's going to be. For myself, I started at quite an early age at my grandparents' farm where I built my first bird feeder by myself. A cleaned out old paint can lid nailed firmly to a convenient piece of post. At that age, the highlight for me was actually to go out and put food on the plate and then watch for the cardinals to come and eat. If I was really lucky, I'd get to see a woodpecker or two, maybe even along with a few chickadees. It was from this rather simple bird feeder that I graduated to a slightly more sophisticated one in my parents' backyard. This time I had a piece of wood for a platform and a pole on which to place it. Although this was quite rudimentary, it did the job, and I'm convinced this was the starting point for my addiction to bird watching and all things birds. From there, I progressed to begging my parents for a pair of binoculars and saving up enough pocket money to buy the scraps and things necessary to build myself a better bird feeder. Naturally, with such enthusiasm, there was always more than one bird feeder around, and at times our backyard was inundated more by my dubious building efforts than actual birds. I never gave up, however, and through many trial and error, along with quite a few trips to my local library to gather more information, I found out what worked best. For instance, I found out that hummingbirds needed nectar and appropriate feeders, that woodpeckers liked peanuts, and that northern cardinals liked feeding close to the ground. Most other birds, I found out, liked the platform method, as did any and every squirrel that it was my luck to confront. I also found out that if I didn't place my feeders in the right place, the neighbor's cat, along with the squirrels, would have easy access to them. With the squirrels, this was more of a food problem where they would generally hoard away all my birdseed. And although the same applied to the cat in that it was food population, this problem involved a diminishing of the bird population as opposed to a diminishing of the supply of birdseed. So I learned quickly and speedily and went on to become a firm birder, which is where we find ourselves now as I try to explain to you exactly what a bird feeder is. From my early rambling discourse, better known as the introduction, you probably got a general idea of what a bird feeder entails, but let me try and go into a little bit more detail if I can, without crossing too much into the same information I've given you in the following sections. You know, or you're vaguely aware, that a bird feeder is a feeding device or station, and that it's also generally found outdoors, most often in your backyard. It can be anything from a fancy bird-sized mansion to an earthier wooden feeder that blends in well with your garden, or it could even be as simple as placing an old baking sheet in your yard and filling it with seed or some other kind of bird food. There's really no easier and simpler way of saying it than to tell you that a bird feeder is anything which holds food for birds and from which they can come and feed. Everything else that follows is just for aesthetics or for the pure fun of it. Since most people have a bird feeder for the pleasure of watching and enjoying many birds that will flock to their gardens, it's safe to assume that the feeder will be placed in a prominent position. Most often, this will be in direct line of sight to a place where you can enjoy the antics of the feathered variety from a safe and comfortable distance. For correct placing information of your feeder, I've gone into more detail in the section, Where to Place Your Bird Feeder. For now, suffice it to say that there's more to bird feeding than meets the eye, so read on and find out for yourself. The reasoning behind bird feeders. The beginning title may or may not have made sense to you, but here's the long and short of what I was trying to convey to you in a one-lined sentence. What's the cause, the driving force, behind having a bird feeder, and why are they built in certain ways? Well, if you're new to this whole bird feeding thing, then you're probably wondering, what's all the fuss about? If you want to feed the birds in your area, then the easiest and simplest method is to do what I did in the beginning of my birding career and place a flat platform type of thing somewhere within easy arm's reach where you can sit and watch the birds. Right? Well, not necessarily. There's more detail that needs to be filled in to get a complete picture. All of the many elaborate types of bird feeders that you can find are intended to fill a gaping void that looms out there if you want to attract more than one or two types of birds to your garden. And if you're doing the whole bird feeding through the kindness of your heart, then you'll definitely want to be providing for all the different types of birds during the cold winter months. This includes all the birds who don't migrate for the winter and who need nourishment as well. Then there's always the necessity to keep out unwanted intruders from the bird feeder stations. The last thing you're going to want to do is have a friendly, chattering squirrel hoard away all your bird food so the actual birds don't get it, or even an inquisitive raccoon raiding your feeding platforms. And let's not forget the purely aesthetic reasons for having a bird feeder. A pleasant-looking bird feeder, as opposed to a paint can lid, is a sight for sore eyes, especially if it's covered with birds scrabbling for food. I can tell you now, there's nothing quite like sitting on the porch swing with a long, cold lemonade in your hands, watching a host of birds flying to and fro in your garden. Now, don't get me wrong here. I wouldn't trade that first paint can lid bird feeder for the newer, shinier feeders on the market. But sometimes it's just nice to sit back and enjoy the sight of that new, shiny feeder in your garden. Those are some of the main reasons behind the growing bird feeder industry. And it's safe to say that many people probably appreciate their bird feeding efforts more because their feeder stations become equipped with all the latest toys, like a squirrel or a raccoon baffle. I go into more detail on those in the sections called baffles. But what about all the different designs and the feeders come in, not to mention the bewildering arrays of shapes and sizes? What do they all mean? How does it all fit in? Well, to begin with, perhaps I should tell you the reason that so many different types of feeders arose was from the picky feeding habits of the many birds. If you'll observe them closely for any length of time, you'll see that some birds prefer to eat from ground level, while some birds will like the height of a pole-mounted platform feeder, and some birds won't take anything other than nectar. If you want to attract only one type of bird to your feeder, then fine. You could go for the most basic feeders and be done with it. But there are some people, like myself, who absolutely must have different feeders to attract more birds to my garden. And that's where the whole different feeders issue comes in. Different feeders equates to different birds coming to your garden. To get a better overview of the feeder types involved, go to the section called Types of Different Feeders. So now perhaps that odd-looking tubular bird feeder, or perhaps even the wire-meshed small box you saw at the store, makes a little more sense when you think that they're all actually fitted to suit a different variety of birds. To find out which bird feeder you'll need and which one's right for you, just go to the next section, How to Choose the Right Bird Feeder. After that, I'll go into more detail and we'll strive to explain what the different types of feeders are and what they can do for you. How to Choose the Right Bird Feeder. How do you choose the right bird feeder for you? What's the first thing you need to do? And is the choice of bird feeder truly an important one? Well, in the beginning, probably not. The choice of your first bird feeder can be simple and rudimentary. You don't really need anything too fancy, and something with a low price tag might actually suit you even better, at least until you make up your mind as to what you really want from your bird feeder. If you've been birding for a while now, however, you won't have too much trouble on deciding what type of bird feeder you'll need, and you might even be able to teach me a thing or two in the bargain. If you're new to this whole birding thing, however, you're probably wondering how on earth you can easily find the right bird feeding station to suit you. A few factors come into the equation of choosing your first bird feeder, and I'll go through them one by one to make your options clearer and easier for you to wade through. If you don't want to go through all this hassle in the beginning, though, or if you just want the pleasure of finding out your birding needs for yourself, then I suggest you go ahead and buy the basic platform bird feeder. It's always the best place to start and can give you a great boost on your learning curve. If you skip on ahead, though, you'll find a few sections later on in this book that might interest you and help your feeding efforts as well. However, if you want to gather as much information as possible before making your choices on which feeder to buy, read on. I've mentioned some facts and essentials that you should consider, and then I'll go into the detail afterward, such as what types of birds do you want to attract to your garden? How durable is your bird feeder? Is maintenance easy? How much seed will the feeder hold? Do you live in a cooler climate or a warmer one? Are you on the migrating path? Do you want to squirrel or raccoon-proof your feeder? Money. How much are you willing to part with? Let's start with what types of birds do you want to attract to your garden? The first and most important question you can ask yourself when buying a feeder is what type of bird or birds do you want to attract to your garden? This is most important, as the choice of feeder is sometimes dictated by the type of bird. For instance, if hummingbirds are what you want to attract to your garden, then investing in a platform feeder won't get you anywhere. Hummingbirds need nectar, and special hummingbird feeders are needed for them to feed from, and the same applies to orioles. But if it's northern cardinals you want, then you'll have to look into buying ground feeders. Or maybe you'll want suet feeders for the woodpeckers and others of its ilk. Hopefully you get the general idea. But if you're new to all of this, you might even now be wondering how on earth you're going to be able to know which birds can be found in your area. That too is a fairly simple problem to overcome. And any field guide native to your area can help you. Or barring that, there's always the internet. Otherwise, you could find more information at your library or perhaps even from a bird society in your area. Once you know all the pertinent details, it's just a matter of narrowing it down to which particular birds you want to attract. After that, you can again resort to these sources to get the lowdown on which feeders the birds prefer, or you could always ask a friendly salesperson from your pet store. Before you go rushing out, however, consider the rest of the points first, as these might also play a significant part of your choice. How durable is your bird feeder? When you're choosing your bird feeder for the first time, you might want to find out how durable your bird feeder is. Is it going to last for at least the length of one season, or will it last a year? Will it crumble to pieces the minute you turn your back on it, or is it going to stand the test of time? I realize that most of these questions are generally unanswerable, especially if you're going to do this for the first time. But the quality that the feeders are constructed of can help you in your endeavors as well. More detail can be found on this subject in the section called How Long Should Your Bird Feeder Last? Regular maintenance of the bird feeder also goes a long way in the prolonging of the life of your feeder and is covered in the section Maintenance. With regular maintenance, you'll find that your bird feeder will stay almost like new over the years, with only the normal wear and tear of daily life affecting it overly. Is maintenance easy? Another deciding factor in choosing your bird feeder should be whether the maintenance of your feeder is going to be easy or difficult. Naturally, this also depends on what type of feeder you're going for, but with only a few exceptions, most bird feeders should be easy to clean and hassle-free. While most feeders will only need to be cleaned at least once or twice a month, specialty feeders like hummingbird or nectar feeders will need to be cleaned at least once a week to promote good hygienic conditions. For proper maintenance information, you can look up the section Maintenance. If cleaning your bird feeder isn't going to be easy, then I suggest you try switching your feeder type to something different, or try different brands of the same feeder. Remember, not all feeders were made equal. How much seed will the feeder hold? The answer to this question is entirely dependent upon yourself. If, like me, you enjoy putting out the bird seed on an almost daily basis, then I'd suggest going for a feeder that won't hold a lot of seed, only enough to feed the birds for a day or two. If, however, you don't want to be continually filling your bird feeder, then I'd suggest looking for a feeder that can hold a large amount of seed in reserve. If you're going for this type, then additionally, you will need to make sure that your feeder is well protected from the elements, as otherwise your seeds will become moldy and unpalatable to the birds. For this type of feeder, you might also want to look into purchasing a squirrel or raccoon baffle to go along with it. Long, untended bird feeders are probably more enticing to squirrels, who are, well, indiscriminate and will eat from any and every source they can find, especially if there's no guard over it. So although squirrels will raid the smaller bird feeders as well as the larger ones, having them hoard away your seed from the large capacity feeders kind of defeats the purpose. I mean, you got them in the first place, so you wouldn't need to be continually refilling the feeder. You might have intended for the seed in the feeder to last you for a long period of time, but that squirrel could not care less about that. Investing in a squirrel baffle is good long-term sense in this case. In the case of a hummingbird feeder, before buying your feeder, you're going to need to first scout out whether you might have a large population to feed or whether it's only one or two. Also, hummingbirds are territorial, especially during mating season. So you might want to think about getting more than one. Some hummers, however, aren't so fierce, and you might get a few hummers coming to feed on one. Large feeders to feed only one or two hummingbirds is not only wasteful, it could also become dangerous if the nectar ferments. So in the beginning, I'd perhaps suggest going for a small, 2-ounce feeder and seeing how many hummers actually come to the yard. From there, it's a simple matter of buying a bigger feeder if you have more hummers than your present feeder can handle. Do you live in the colder climates or the more warmer ones? Well, once you've found out what type of birds you want to attract, you'll next want to find out whether they'll be around throughout the year or whether they're going to be migrating. If you live in a warm climate, there's a good chance your choice of bird is assured to be found nearby throughout the year. But if you live in the more colder climates, you might find that your preferred birds aren't to be found in the cold winter months. You might, however, want to feed the other birds that live in your area who don't migrate while the other ones are gone. Again, the same source that supplied you with the information on the birds in your area can supply you with other necessary information on finding the migrating patterns of birds, which brings us to our next point. Are you on the migrating paths? If you're on the migrating paths of birds, then you could be well rewarded lushly with an amazing number of different birds. To take advantage of this fact, you might want to shell out a little bit more cash and invest in more than one bird feeder. But I'd recommend first scoping out the situation for at least a year before you go all crazy and buy out the bird section. If other birders in your area have the same idea, you might not be able to attract too many birds to your garden, since there's more than likely to be an abundance of food readily available to these birds. Having different types of feeding stations, however, could attract quite a variety of birds. And checking out their migrating bird species for your area can help you in choosing your bird feeders. Do you want to squirrel and raccoon-proof your feeder? Another point to take into consideration is whether you want to squirrel-proof your feeder. Remember that squirrels are notorious little thieves and will hoard any little bit of food you keep out. I personally like the little pesky critters and find a way to separate my squirrels from my birds, although that can be a difficult task at the best of times. This decision's entirely up to whether you have the tolerance whatsoever for squirrels or not, though. If you do want to squirrel-proof your feeder, you'll be glad to find out that there are many feeders that can provide you with this facility and you don't have to spend the extra cash. And if you don't want to spend the extra cash on this, then you always have the choice of fighting the squirrel battle on your own terms. Now, warning, this may cause you severe headaches and will take you countless hours to do so. And even in the end, you still might not win the battle. Money. How much are you willing to part with? Despite of everything that you've decided upon up to this point, sometimes the crunch comes here. Just as bird feeders come in different shapes, sizes, and varieties, they also come in different money ranges. So although you might have decided to get a state-of-the-art platform bird feeder that will incorporate a squirrel baffing along with it, if the price is too high, you might have to re-evaluate your needs and go for something a little less expensive. Then again, you also have the option of just building your own bird feeder from scratch. I've anticipated that problem as well, and you should be able to find instructions for a rudimentary bird feeder in the section titled Building Your Own Bird Feeder. Generally speaking, though, you'll find that most feeders are priced reasonably, and you shouldn't have too much trouble finding one to suit your requirements and your budget. Where can you buy your bird feeder? Now that you've decided to get a bird feeder, you're probably feeling a little anxious until you can actually go out there and buy the feeder. Your next question is probably going to be, where do I buy a feeder? The question can be answered easily and leaves you with many options to try. There's no proper answer or proper place from which to buy your feeder. Whether you buy one off the ever-popular internet or whether you go into a store and buy it, it's purely personal. For my part, I'm more old school and I like to see what I'm getting before I actually buy something. But recent tentative forays I've made into the world of internet buying has shown me that there's nothing wrong with buying off the internet. Like I said, the choice is personal rather than anything else. But here's, hopefully, a handy list of places where you can buy your feeders. First, the internet. The shop of choice for a lot of people, this option saves you time and sheer effort since you have the luxury of making purchases from the comfort of your home. Typing in a simple phrase like, where to buy bird feeders, into your favorite search engine will yield a multitude of results from which you can choose whichever one catches your eye. The advantage of internet shopping is that you're spoiled for choice, whereas with a normal shop, all you have is what you find in the store. The pet store. If you don't want the internet option, then this is your next best choice, since the pet store generally carries anything and everything that you could ever want or need that has to do with animals. Appropriate bird seed is also probably available to buy, right along with friendly advice on how best to proceed in your new hobby. A specialty store. These are just the ticket. If you can find one in your neighborhood, and they should carry just about everything that an ardent birder needs, from suet cages to hummingbird feeders to binoculars and seeds, with an added touch of birding books and birdhouses. Specialty bird stores can, however, tend to be slightly pricey, so know your facts and figures before you shell out too much for that one-of-a-kind bird feeder. A garden shop. This is another good place in which to find your birding needs. Garden shops are in abundance these days, and most will carry a number of odds and ends with birding materials thrown literally all over. Here, you should be able to find generic feeders that will also complement your garden. Department stores garden section. Most large department stores will usually have a garden section, and you should be able to find all you need here, although your choices might be considerably less than anywhere else. However, along with basic feeders, you might come across the more elaborate feeders, which will cost you a pretty penny, but will enhance the look of your garden as well as attract the birds. And the hardware shop. This one might be a bit of a puzzler, but it serves a dual purpose. Firstly, in the larger, bigger name hardware stores, you'll come across a garden section, in which case you're going to find your bird feeders. However, my main purpose in mentioning hardware shops at places to get your bird feeders lies in the abundance of materials you can find there to build your own bird feeders. So, unlikely though it is, a hardware store is also a good place to find your bird feeder, albeit in bird feeder kits with pieces that usually require thought and assembly. How long should your bird feeder last? Naturally, the answer to this question depends entirely upon the quality of your bird feeder. I found, however, that most bird feeders, regardless of price, will last at least as long as 2 or 3 years if taken care of regularly. This also takes into account only minimally harsh weather conditions. I wouldn't necessarily guarantee that your bird feeder, no matter how sturdy and durable, would last through a hurricane or tornado or even an especially harsh blizzard. So, barring unforeseen problems and weather events, how long should your bird feeder last? It's largely dependent upon the quality construction and quality of materials used for your bird feeder. A really good, sturdily built, durable bird feeder constructed from the finest of materials can last anywhere upwards of 2 to 3 years without too much of a problem. And if you take care of it and maintain your feeder regularly, that estimate should go up considerably. You need to be realistic about those things, though. Besides the freakish weather conditions that I mentioned to you, your bird feeder will be subject to normal weather conditions, and these will take their toll on it as well. Sunlight, rain, frost, even light winds can all leave their mark upon your feeder. In these cases, you probably won't even notice the wear and tear that occurs until your feeder actually falls apart in your hands, leaving you with a big old pack of hungry birds and no feeder. Not necessarily a scene out of, you know, the movie Birds, I promise, though. Also, if you invest in one of those nylon socks used as a thistle feeder, there's also a good probability that your feeder won't last more than a year or so. All estimates are just that, of course, estimates. And your 10-year-old thistle sock feeder hanging full of seeds is probably mocking me right now. Having said all of that, though, when you're buying your new bird feeder, look for the warranty you'll be getting. Some brands, like the Droll Yankee brand feeders, provide a lifetime guarantee for their feeders. Some of the feeders even have a warranty against squirrel damage. From my experience, this only makes the feeders squirrel-resistant to a greater degree, not completely squirrel-proof. I have yet to see a squirrel who hasn't found a way around the so-called squirrel-proofing methods. On the other hand, if you decide to construct your bird feeder yourself, you're going to have more of a say in the longevity of your feeder than you would otherwise. You'll have a choice of making your feeder from the finest materials around, or you can even make it from scraps of lumber and such that you know won't last out the year. If you enjoy building things and you choose to do it this way, then you always have the option of tearing down your old feeder and replacing it with a newer, cleaner feeder every year. You still need to clean the feeder regularly, but in this way you can be assured that whatever germs and bacteria have burrowed their way into their feeder, they won't live for a long time.